Well, happy Mother's Day. If you're a mom, why don't you stand up real quick? Why don't you stand up in the room? Yeah, give it up for them. Amazing. Happy Mother's Day. We love you. You guys can take a seat. We are grateful for you. We would not be here without you, literally. We are grateful for you and your influence in our lives and in our worlds and in our world. I'll never forget when I, when I moved out of my house for the first time, which I didn't go away to school, so I lived under the same roof for almost 24 years. And when I moved out, I moved 15 minutes away. And I remember I was doing this the day I was leaving, particularly when I hugged my mom. And so I remember chatting with her and just saying, thank you. And thank you for your influence on my life. Thank you for your love. And later that night, she sent kind of an emotional text, I think, if I remember right. And one of the things, the sentences that she shared in that text was, I've prayed for you every day since you were born, every day. And so that's a lot of prayers that I think have held me up and made a big influence on my life. And so I don't even know if my mom's in the room, but actually she's not. She's with her mom right now. But if you're watching online, happy Mother's Day. I love you. Again, to all of you, we honor you and are very grateful for your influence on our lives. And to the young moms, to the older moms in the room, and to everyone in between, we're grateful. And I was at a meal this week or hanging out with friends this week, and there was someone who said in a season of her life where they weren't able to have kids, and she was actually trying with her husband to have kids, and she wasn't able to have kids, but I'm guessing maybe there are some people in this space, whether you're married and haven't been able to have a child, or maybe you're single and you desire to be married with kids, you desire to be a mother. A day like today could be difficult and challenging, and she said Mother's Day was hard, and they had a Mother's Day gathering at her in-laws, and she got a letter from her mother-in-law, and it said, Happy Mother's Day. About all of the younger Christians and people that she mothered. And she said that was one of the most powerful, impactful Mother's Day gifts she's ever gotten, and that was before she was a mom. And so it's a good reminder to you women who greatly desire to have the kids that you have a great responsibility to mother and to impact the next generation, particularly raising them up to know and to love God. And what a privilege that is. And so I'm going to welcome Beth Neighbors, who's a great mom herself, to come up on the stage. And she's just going to she's going to say a prayer over all the moms in the space.
Father God, we thank you so much for moms. We thank you for this day where we can just take a moment to thank moms for all that they do. And so we just pray that you would help us as moms to just continue to seek you on a daily basis, to know how we should be good moms, and that we should forgive ourselves when things don't go our way or when things don't stay in control like we think they should. I just ask that you would give moms grace today to just look back and feel like I'm doing a good job, and that you would just, all the moms would feel super encouraged today. And I also pray, as Josh said, that we would take opportunities as a church family to step in as surrogate mothers for people who don't have moms or who we can influence for the kingdom, that you would just help us to encourage everyone in your kingdom as you would have us to do, not just as biological moms, but as moms that you've put in people's lives to mentor and to help raise them up. So I just ask that all the moms here would feel a special blessing today, and that you would just make your presence known to each of them. We love you, Jesus. Amen.
Well, we're going to have a great morning of worship today. Why don't you stand up, say hello to someone around you. You can tell someone Happy Mother's Day if you want, and then we're going to go to God in worship. Thank you.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense. And I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I built my life on Jesus. And he's never let me down. He's faithful through every season. So why would he fail?
I've never been more glad.
He won't fail. He won't fail. He generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb, and all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. 'Cause your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all, and all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name, it stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries. Been forgiven, if you've been redeemed, sing the song forever to the Lamb. If you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, sing the song forever to the Lamb.
Would you all take a seat for a few minutes? We're going to take communion together, so why don't you all on your own go to God with whatever's on your heart. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Jesus. We praise you for who you are, for what you've done. Thank you for creating us, for giving us life, for bringing us here this morning. And Father, we thank you for your grace that is offered to each and every one of us right here this morning. Thank you that no matter what we've done, no matter what we came through those doors with, that sin has been paid for by the blood of Jesus shed on the cross. That all it takes is coming to you and asking for your forgiveness, for believing in that sacrifice of Jesus, and we can be made perfect, that we can be made righteous, right with you. And have a hope and a future unlike anything this world has to offer. Father, thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you that you didn't leave us in our sin, but that you came and you died, not because of anything we've done, but because of who you are and your great love with which you've loved each and every one of us. And Father, so would you empower us to live lives worthy of that calling, live lives worthy of that message. Would you empower us to give you the glory and honor that you deserve, the praise that you are worthy of, Lord. Would you help us, give you our all today and every day. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So if you would call yourself a believer in Jesus, we would invite you to take of the Lord's Supper with us together as one body of believers. So if you would, peel back the top layer and let's take of the bread together, which represents the body of Christ broken for us. And of the cup, which represents the blood of Christ poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Would you all stand with us one more time and let's give it our all as we praise Jesus.
Yes, we crown you, we fall.
face down and we worship. We all cry out, you are worthy, God. You are worthy, God. To the one who came, it's very upon himself all our guilt and shame, hanging on a cross for the world he loved with his precious blood, purchased men for God. we crown you. We fall face down and we worship. We all cry out, you are worthy, God. You are worthy, God.
You all can take a seat. And kind of like last week, we're going to have a psalm on the screen. So if you have your Bible, if you have your fake Bible on your phone, you can pull those out, highlight whatever you want to highlight. And in our kind of daily readings, if you're going through the Bible, we're reading a lot of psalms, and they kind of correlate with some of the narrative going on in the Old Testament. And so today we're going to look at Psalm 133. And so you can pray over these verses, reflect on them, meditate on them for a few minutes, and then we're going to do our best to think through it together for the remaining moments we have together. Dear Father, we ask that you speak in these few moments together as we kind of just reflect and meditate on these beautiful words from an ancient song that our forefathers in the faith sang together and reflected on and thought about. So may it be a blessing to us. Thank you for preserving your word through the ages against all odds, as many people have tried to destroy them and to blot them out from history, but you have been a good God and been faithful to keep your word. And though the flowers fall and the leaf withers, the word of the Lord remains forever. And so we ask that you speak to us today, and it's in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Unity. I think this is a beautiful passage for Mother's Day. This is a refreshing passage, I'm sure, as I think we all strive to live in harmony with one another. There was some disunity in the Noblet household on Thursday. I think it was Thursday, maybe Wednesday. There was that day where all the storm, it was just raining all day. And we went out later on after it had stopped raining, and we jumped in puddles. And at first it was cute and it was fun. And I had to control myself from showing pictures because it was that cute and that fun. And but after a while, it got to where anytime Josie was near the puddle that Georgia was at, Georgia would kick water onto Josephine. And Josie's smaller, younger, wasn't about that at all. And so Josie would start crying. And I eventually just said, hey, Georgia, you need to pick on somebody your own size or bigger. And so if you want to splash, you need to splash me, but I'm going to splash you back. And so it needs to be calculated. You need to think about this. If you want to do this thing, we'll do it. If you want to play this game, we'll play it. But you got to do it with Dad. And so at first, she's kind of thinking through it. And then obviously, as a three-year-old, she's like, let's go after it, right? And so she splashes me. And then I'm like, okay. And so then I splashed her back. And we kind of went on and on for, it was a few minutes, you know, and so probably splashed her 5-6 times, and my splashes were much bigger than hers, and so she was wet, and the water was cold, and so we're walking back to the house, and Abby was there with Josie, because Josie is like, I'm done with this, right, and so she goes back, and she hangs out with Abby, and Abby was FaceTiming her mom at the time, and me and Georgia literally just, I'm bickering with my three-year-old. Georgia's like, Daddy, I'm all wet. I'm like, yeah, and I never splashed you first. She's like, yes, you did. I'm like, no, I didn't. I never splashed you first. Like, you splashed me first, and I warned you multiple times. And so we're arguing, and Abby is on FaceTime with her mom, and I hear Abby go, oh, Josh is just arguing with Georgia. Josh is bickering with Georgia, right? And that's a silly example. But over the years in the Noblet household, in the Noblet marriage, in friendships, there are times where you just kind of feel it. There's disharmony. There's disunity. Something's off. Have you ever felt that way in like your friendships? In your friendships where you just aren't really vibing. You aren't gelling. You can just tell that something's off. You're not in sync, heading in the same direction. Moms, you ever felt that way with your kids? Married couples, you ever felt that way with your spouse? Or something's just off. Church people, you ever felt that way with your church people? You ever felt that way with your crew? You ever felt that way again, kind of with the body of Christ, where something is just off? But I want to take it a step further and ask a question. Again, that's a goofy, kind of cute example of something's off. We're not gelling, right? But have you ever been in relationship within the body of Christ, blood related or not, because many of your family, you're believers, where it's not just that something might be off, where it feels like there's just a little tension, but you know there's been a sever. There's been a sever to the unity that God calls you to have. And there's brokenness in your relationship with one another. Gossip can do this. For me, I think mixed up priorities and self-absorption can do this. Bitterness and unforgiveness can do this. Anger can do this. Disregard for authority can do this. Complaining can do this. Again, apathy can do this. A lack of faith in God. In fact, I think that's the root of it, can do this. And we see in the scriptures that disunity is dangerous. Disunity is dangerous. In fact, I think disunity is Satan's breeding ground to do some big work, especially in his gathering. It's a big deal. God hates disunity. God hates disunity. Proverbs 16:16 through 19 says this: there are six things the Lord hates, seven that are detestable to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush into evil, a false witness who pours out lies, and a person who stirs up conflict in the community, or a person who sows discord, other translations say, in the community, within the people of God. And again, I don't need to go into all the ways that relationally, well, we can cause strains, how we can cause
discord, how we can bring about disunity among the brethren. We know that all too well. We know that all too well. You know how that's been brought about maybe in your relationships with people when they've done it to you. And I think this passage should cause us to look inwards and say, hey, within all of my relationships, but specifically in the body of Christ, is this something that I'm doing my best to guard against? Am I fighting for unity? Am I fighting for oneness? It's important to God, so much so that when Jesus is praying, not long before he goes to the cross, by the way, in John chapter 17, it's the end of his life, one of the last recorded prayers in the Gospels, and look at what he prays. The whole prayer is powerful. He starts out by praying for his disciples, prays for their protection, not that they would be taken out of the world, but that they would be sent into it with power, but that they would be protected from evil, that he would be glorified, that they would be sanctified, and that they would have joy. That's essentially the prayer he prays for his disciples, which I think is powerful to think about. And then he prays for all who will believe. And the reason I know that is as he said this, my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. That's so powerful. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. This is so repetitive in just a few verses. Notice, then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you have loved me before the creation of the world. This is powerful. May they be one. May they be unified. And as I was studying and listening to a lot of different commentaries this week, just kind of on John chapter 17, a question that I heard somebody ask, I don't remember who asked it, was a powerful question. Are you, in answer to Jesus' prayer in regards to the life that you live, in regards to this prayer and the unity that God prays for within the community of believers throughout all time who will believe in his name, are you an answer to that prayer or are you a hindrance? Are you a hindrance to the answer? You're a hindrance. But I guess what is unity? What is unity? We all love that idea. We all love that idea. In fact, this is an American idea, right? It's been our motto since 1776, right? When the Declaration of Independence was signed, there was a motto that was actually brought about. We can throw it up. Those three words are the Latin phrase, E pluribus unum. I don't know how to pronounce Latin. But it means out of many, one. Out of many, one. Out of our diversity with people who are immigrating from a bunch of different regions, out of the 13 colonies, we are one. We're one. We are to be unified. And I think all of us would say, oh, yeah, our country needs unity. Right? This is one of those years where we're going to probably feel the opposite, right? And I think we all long for unity, even in a national sense. I'm fine with saying that. But the unity that we hope for as the United States of America is that we tolerate folks that we're not unified with in regards to our worldview and our thoughts, right? I mean, let's be honest. I think the best we can hope for in regards to unity is that we realize, oh, those people who I don't want to go in the same direction with are made in the image of God, and I'm going to treat them with dignity and respect. And so out of many, we're going to be one in the sense that we don't kill each other, right? Honestly, though, look at our nation's history. Let's not put our head in the sand here and act as if the unity in our national sense right now, the bar is pretty low. The standard's pretty low. What people would consider unity, again, is that we tolerate one another, and I'm fine with that, right? We treat people with dignity and respect, but that is not biblical unity. That is not the unity that we are to have in our homes as believers in Jesus. That is not the unity that we are called to have as the church of Jesus Christ. The standard is much higher than that. The call is much higher than that. Paul in Philippians 1 says that we are to be like-minded. We are to be of one spirit and of one mind. We are to value the other above ourselves, looking not to our own interest, but to the interest of others. I'm sorry, but I don't want to be of one mind and of one spirit with many people in the United States of America. And I would say that about every country, and so would you. I don't want to be like-minded, of one spirit, and of one mind with all 330 million, however many people are, how many people are in our country? That sounded fine. I have no clue. There's way more than that. I don't know. Who knows? I don't know. But look, let's be honest. I have been taken out of a kingdom that does not belong to God and to Christ, and I've been put into the kingdom of God where, again, the what we believe, what we think, how we act, how we treat people, all of these things, the standard is entirely different. But I want that with the body of Christ. I want that with the people of God. And this is a beautiful picture. Philippians chapter 2, to be like-minded, to be of one spirit, to be of one mind, to value the interests of the other above our own. What does that look like? Oh, Christ, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing, took the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. He was found in appearance as a man, and he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. What's the unity? What is the unity? What does it mean to be like-minded? What does it mean to be of one spirit and of one mind? It is to believe that Jesus is who he says he is, that what he says is true, and that we are to follow his example for the sake of the brethren. It's a beautiful picture. And so rather than looking and thinking about how we could potentially stir disunity, I want to use Psalm 133 kind of as our reward. It's our reward. What we get is a beautiful picture when we actually carry this life out. And I actually want to kind of journey through a couple ideas from the narrative where we're at in First Chronicles that I think is the unity, or at least what led to the people of God's unity. And so there's the model. We're going to look at the model in First Chronicles and the reward in Psalm 133. At this point in the story, it's about 20 years after David has been promised the throne. And we read about it this week where David becomes king of the entire nation. So it's not just one tribe like it was, which for a while it was, before he had reign over the whole nation. 11 tribes weren't under his reign. One was. It was a time of great division. But now David has the throne over all the people of God. And there are many scholars, some scholars believe that Psalm 133 was written during this time when David finally becomes king of all the people. I think it's speculation personally. Other people think that it was when David escaped from Absalom when he was trying to kill him. Nonetheless, I think it's a cool picture of unity here, no matter what was going on in the time of Psalm 133. So, 1 Chronicles chapter 11, 1 and 2 says this. All Israel came together to David at Hebron and said, "We are your own flesh and blood. In the past, even while Saul was king, you were the one who led Israel on their military campaigns. And the Lord your God said to you, 'You will shepherd my people Israel and you will become their ruler.'" And so David is now king. They're united under his leadership. This is good. This is good. You see battles begin to be won. There are some military battles. There's some violence. It's Mother's Day. We're going to keep it PG, so we'll skip the battles. But they win some battles early, and then we're going to move on a couple chapters later, and we'll begin to see a couple things that seem to unite the people of God. First Chronicles 13, then David consulted with the captains of the thousands and the hundreds, even with every leader. David said to all the assembly of Israel, if it seems good to you, and if it is from the Lord our God, let us send everywhere to our kinsmen who remain in all the land of Israel, also to the priests and Levites who are with them in their cities, with their pasture lands, that they may meet us and let us bring back the ark of our God to us. For we did not seek it in the days of Saul. And so the first thing you see is a priority to seek God. The ark of the covenant represents the presence of God. This is the wooden box made of acacia wood, a lot of acacia wood in the book of Exodus and Numbers, with gold that covered it, and it contained the Ten Commandments. This was placed in the tabernacle where God met with his people. The throne of God, essentially, that contains the word of God. And David's first concern, it seems like, is that we're going to bring that back. And he doesn't do it perfectly. If we had more time to read, it's hasty. It seems like the passion's there, but God wants to be approached in a specific way. He misses the mark a little bit, but no doubt his priority is to seek the presence and the person of God. And for 20 years, it says, in fact, in the days of Saul, they did not seek it. And I think that's important to note. As a community, in our lives, in our circles, in our conversations, in our small groups, is our number one priority to meet with God, to prioritize seeking God, to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, believing that all the other stuff will follow suit. Is that our main priority? That's why I think reading through the Bible, goodness gracious, we have to be in it. We have to be in it. I love, hey, let's go grab the ark. Again, there's the presence of God, but in the ark is the very word of God, etched into tablets of stone. And so I wonder, as a community of believers, is our number one priority in life, where a lot of different things call for our allegiance, is it to meet with God? And whether you are sold out on this whole Jesus thing or not, if you believe that there is a God who is knowable, from a logical standpoint, we would all agree, if there is a God who has made himself knowable to where we can step into a relationship with him, we would all, in our right mind, say, yeah, that should probably be the number one pursuit and priority of our lives. And so my hope is, you know, even now, you could jump in. We're in Psalms and in the story of David. It's fun. And I just want to give you, as we kind of are going to continue to read the Psalms for a while, just something that I've started doing over the past couple weeks when I have the discipline to actually sit down and not just read it, but actually meditate on it, a good little model to follow. And so it's called MAPS. It's called MAPS. So that's the acronym. And so the M represents meditation and memorization. If you're going to read the Bible, again, if I'm not careful with Bible reading plans, I'm just like, got to check it off today. Let's throw it on audio when I'm in the car. But I don't think that's the purpose of the Word of God and seeking the presence of God. I want to hear from him. I want to know him more. I want to love him more. I want my affections stirred. And so to meditate is to reflect on. I think memorize it. Next, apply it. How does this impact my head and my beliefs? How does this impact my heart and my affections? How does this impact my hands and what I do and how I serve and how I live? Next, pray over the passage. Repent over areas of your life that fall short of God's standard in the scriptures and pray that his power would lead you into obedience. And then next, I think this is really important. Share it with somebody. Share it with somebody. Share it with a family member. Share it with friends. This is what God's speaking in my life. Share it with your spouse. Share it with someone in your world, which, again, it's a Mother's Day talk, so let's chat about the family a little bit. Are we sharing these types of things in our families? are these conversations we ever have? And I want us to be convicted in this moment as moms and as dads. Is this a priority for us? Are we seeking the presence of God, the Word of God in our homes? Is it modeled? What does that look like? And the model for us in the Old Testament and throughout, I think the call of Scripture is to, you put this on your doorpost. You talk about this. You hang this stuff all over your house. This is everything. It's everything. Is it everything for our families? Is our main priority for our kids and for our loved ones to know God, to know Jesus? And then a more challenging question is this. If the answer is yes, would your kids know that? By the way that you parent, by the way that you speak, by the way that you pray, by the way that you get your Bible out, by the way that you do these things, would your kids know that your main concern and priority for their life as your son or daughter is that they would know God and know God more? And if the answer is no, I heard a preacher not too long ago on a little viral Instagram video, he started yelling a lot louder than I'm going to, but he said, that's code red. I guess I did kind of yell, but it's code red. Your priorities are all out of whack if your kids think that your main hope and priority for them is anything less than them knowing God and knowing him more. If it revolves around material wealth, if it revolves around academic success, if it revolves around social skills, if they don't know beyond a shadow of a doubt that your main priority for them is their walk with God, adjustments need to be made. Next, we see worship to God. Worship to God. 1 Chronicles 16, 7 through 11. That day, David first appointed Asaph and his associates to give praise to the Lord in this manner. This is after the ark is set up. Give praise to the Lord. Proclaim his name. Make known among the nations what he's done. Sing to him. Sing praise to him. Tell of all of his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord in his strength. Seek his face always. I love this picture. Give thanks to the Lord at the end of this song, for he is good. His love endures forever. You see, worship to God, right relationship with God, understanding that they're in the presence of God leads to exuberant singing and praise. If you're paying attention to the Psalms, you'd be hard pressed as a preacher not to look at the people of God and say, sing, sing. Make music to God in your hearts and your minds and with your lips. Sing. And you begin to see, even in the Psalms, it outlines what worship does. Worship expresses gratitude. Worship shifts perspective. Worship realigns our affections. Worship unifies the people. Worship reminds us we're not alone. Worship shelters us, David says this, in the care of a loving God. And Psalm 133, scholars believe, is actually a song. It's one of the songs of ascent. And we actually have a modern day song of it. Maybe you remember it. How good and pleasant it is when we dwell together in unity. I was just in the verse, guys. Goodness gracious. I'm just kidding. But it was a song, and these were songs that the people of God would sing together as they were heading up the mount to Jerusalem for the festivals, for the feasts. That's a cool picture. There are like 15 of them. So the people of God congregationally, as they're journeying, as they're venturing to celebrate God's faithfulness to provide in the previous year, both agriculturally and spiritually, and what he'd done in the past to set them free, and also some of the feasts were in expectancy for what God would do, they're singing on the way. And so this is a good picture. They didn't just sing when they were feasting, which they did. They sang at the feast too, but they sang on the journey. And this is essential, and it's a unifier. Whether we're on the mountain or in a valley, whether we're in Zion or in the desert, whether we're feasting or hungry, whether we're eating or whether we're drinking or thirsty, we worship God. We sing songs to our God. The world's got a lot of songs. So do we. So do we. And I'm good with singing the other songs. That's not about, I'm just saying we have songs that belong to us and we sing them. The world's got a lot of little g gods they sing to, bow down to, worship. We have one. And a lot of songs are devoted to him. And we sing to him. You can't preach these psalms without saying, hey, people, sing. I remember there was one time we were out of town and we were hanging out with folks who weren't believers, and they're great. We love them, all good. But it was, we got in a lot of conversations, worldview conversations, faith conversations about God and life, and there was tension during that weekend. And we were just gonna drive home in the car and just watch it online. But I was like, hey, we're out of town. I want to go to church. After that weekend, I need church. And so we went to church, and we walked into a place we'd never been, and we sang, and I remember I cried, and I lifted my hands, and I chatted with some people around me, and I remember just having this thought, these are our songs. It felt like a shelter from what goes on in the outside world. And then it felt like, man, these are our people. I don't know them, but these are our people. And so now, mothers, fathers, are we singing with our families? Are we worshiping with our families? Are our homes unified in praise and worship? And look, right now I sing a lot of Moana. And I sing a lot of Frozen 2. And I sing a lot of Frozen 1. And I actually kind of like the jams. Goodness gracious, I feel like I sing Kristoff's parts well. Okay, I do. And I enjoy it. But I control the songs that are sung in the house. Abby controls the songs that are sung in the house. So, hey, no, babe. Kristoff's going to turn off, and we're going to turn on Becca, Amelia, Anna, Gabby, all right? And we're going to worship, and we're going to think about God. We have to. And then next, we see ministry for the people of God. This is so important. He appointed some of the Levites to minister before the ark of the Lord, to extol, thank, and praise the Lord, the God of Israel, on down. David left Asaph and his associates before the ark of the covenant of the Lord to minister there regularly according to each day's requirements. They're offering sacrifices. They're offering reminders of the law to the people. They're carrying out fellowship offerings. They're having meals together. They're ministering to the people of God. And so our church exists so that people far from God would find life in Christ. Our church exists so that we'd make followers of Jesus, who in turn make followers of Jesus. And a massive part of that is we want to see people born again. We want to see people whose eyes are open for the very first time that Jesus is who he says he is, that he loves them, that he can step into a relationship with them that lasts forever. That's kind of what makes our heart beat. But here's what I know. The church doesn't just exist so that people would be saved. That's a huge part of why we exist. That's high on the priority list, and I don't ever want it to get low. But the church also exists so that the people would be shepherded. And so we want needs to be met. We want lives carried out in community. We want prayers to be offered up. We want souls to be tended to. We want seasons to be walked through hand in hand. Oftentimes there are people who are needy that come to the church, and they probably, honestly it sounds bad, but they probably make their rounds to the churches around, just ask for money. And sometimes we say yes, and here's a gift card or whatever. A lot of times we say no. But every time here's what I say to people. We would love to have you at church, and we would love to really have you at church, and I would love for you to get plugged into a community of people and in a small group, and I'm telling you right now, there will be people who walk alongside you and needs will be met. So yes, the doors are open, but going for a $20 bill here, there, that's not sustainable. Come to the church, come to know Christ, start following Jesus, get in a small group, And we would love to walk alongside of you in life. And it might not be in the exact way that you want it to or think it should be carried out, but I have seen needs met. I have seen seasons walked through. I have seen baby showers held. I have seen bridal showers held with folks who barely know each other in small groups because it's a family of God, and that's what we do. And so, so, So yes, I want people saved, but we also need people shepherded. Ministry happens, and when ministry happens, people stay. But then notice, after the ministry happens in the congregation where the ark is set up, all the people left, each for their own home. David went and blessed his family. So again, it goes back to your home. Are you shepherding them? Are you asking how you can pray for your kids? Are you tending to their souls? And this seems to be what defined the unity of God's people in the early days of David's reign. They prioritized the presence of God. They worshiped and celebrated in the presence of God. They ministered to the people, and there's more. They fought together. They knew their enemy. They were unified against them. They won some battles. They honored David, all these different things. They knew their roles. But central to their unity, as they were like-minded of one spirit, pursuing God, ministering to the people, is that they did it together, congregationally, and they did it in their homes. And maybe, again, maybe, in this time period, David says how good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. It is like precious oil poured out on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down on the collar of his robe. It is as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion, for there the Lord bestows blessing, even life forevermore. So the first thing he says, it's good, it's pleasant, and then he says it's like oil, oil, which represents anointing in the Old Testament. And over the years, I've had some strangers I've never met come into the church, and they anoint my head with oil. I'm not sure how I feel about it, but I'm always like, yeah, is it sticky? All right, I'm not one for textures. In the Old Testament, in the ancient Middle East, oftentimes you'd hold a dinner gathering and you would anoint your guests with oil, and it was a sign of refreshing. It smelled good. It was a sign of honor. But it was also a sign of power. This consecrated the people of God for the works of God, for ministry. When Elijah anoints Elisha with oil, which we'll get there in the story before long, the power of God comes upon him and miracles take place. James says we're to anoint people with oil for healing. It represents the power of God. And so he says our unity is like oil. It's refreshing and it's powerful. You want power in your family? Unity. Of one mind and of one spirit. You want power in your small group? Unity. You want power even maybe in your workplace? You want power in your spheres of influence, your friend circles? We want power in this church. We need to protect unity at all costs. It's a powerful thing. God does what he does, when he wants to do it, how he wants to do it, but throughout the ages, he seemed to use and work upon a unified church. Acts chapter 2, all the people were together and in one accord, it says. And then what happens? Power breaks out. Power takes place. 3,000 are added that first day. So are you protecting it? Are you fighting for it? Are you living it out? Next, we see dew from Hermon that goes down to Zion. And dew represents health for the land. But also this dew that reaches from Hermon down to Zion represents reach. Mount Hermon rises above the upper Jordan Valley, had its share of heavy rain. And it flowed down into the valley. It fed the Jordan River, and it reached as far as the oasis of Jericho, one scholar says. And so an arid country where the rain is scarce and the rivers dry up, the land and the people depend on water that comes from a distant source. It is the scarcity of water in the dry lands which makes Mount Hermon's dew so precious. And so our unity not only impacts the mountain we're on, but it feeds faraway lands. David's fame spread throughout every land. The Lord made all nations fear him. And Jesus says in his prayer in John chapter 17, that if we're one as he is one, if we're one as he is one, and he repeats himself twice, then the world will know that God the Father sent God the Son to live, to die, and to rise from the dead. Gospel proclamation amongst the people of God, with folks who are far from God, is essential. But Jesus says, I pray that the people of God live in harmony with one another to the point where people actually have any interest to begin with. I want to be a part of a community like that. This is what you see in the early church, in the Roman Empire, counterculture. They treat women and kids different. They love one another. They serve one another. They give to one another. They care for one another. They carry each other's burdens, and they represent to the world Jesus, who came, lived, died, and sacrificed for them. May it be so with Oak Bridge City. Father, we love you. Grateful that you're a good God. Grateful that you allow us as broken, feeble human beings to represent you in a lost and hurting world. And God, I pray that we do so well. I pray that we prioritize your presence. I pray that we sing your praises. I pray that we shepherd and feed your sheep. And I pray that Oak Bridge City, and I pray that that little Baptist church down the road, and I pray that the Lutheran church behind us and the Catholic churches all around could be places that speak of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Christ crucified and risen from the dead. And I pray for churches all over this state, and I pray for churches all over this country and all over our world, that not only do we preach a message that is powerful to save souls, but we live it. That we love one another, that we forgive one another, that we apologize to one another. And God, I pray for moms specifically today, and for dads, and for homes, that this would be modeled first in our living rooms and around our dinner tables and in our marriages and in our relationships with one another and in our car rides, that we would be unified, that we would be like, that we would be like-minded, of one spirit and of one accord and of one mind, to sacrifice for one another the way that Jesus sacrificed for us. Lord, may a revolution take place in this region and beyond. May more and more and more and more and more people come to know Jesus. And it starts in the home, and it starts in gatherings like this and circles like this. May we be your people. May we believe your truth, and may we live it. And may we sing your praises, whether we're on the mountain or in the valley, whether it's feast or famine, because your love endures forever. Amen, amen, amen. Let's stand. Let's sing this song.
Were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What a wonderful name it is. Death could not hold you, veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again, and you.
Give me 2 minutes. Give me 2 minutes. Aaron was the joker who led the people into false worship back in the book of Exodus. We preached on this. And he's the one who's anointed with refreshing and powerful oil that blesses his beard and on down to his clothes. And so I know for days like today, let's be honest, moms, you're not perfect and it's okay. You won't be. Dads, you're not perfect. Your homes aren't going to be perfect. And so when I give a message like this, I hope for healthy conviction where you can go out and make some changes. But probably more than that, I want encouragement. There's a second chance for Aaron. If there's a second chance for that joker, there's a second chance for you. And it can start now. And it can start today. And so understand there's grace for you. There are kids who have gone wayward. God's good. God's gracious. That is not on you. And so I hope that that covers you today, that you're encouraged and you understand there are countless second chances at the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ. And I hope you walk out of here knowing that, that you're encouraged,
to maybe make changes, but maybe more than that, you're encouraged just to rest in the grace of God as someone who's been used mightily and wonderfully and powerfully in the lives of your kids. And again, I hope you know that we're grateful for you. We'll give it up for him one more time, one more time, one more time. All right. I want to be out of here. I want to be out of here by 11:20. If it's your first time, we'd love to meet you. Head outside these doors. And then the last announcement I have is the 24th. The 24th of May, next Friday, not this coming Friday night, the following Friday night at 5:30 to 8:30, we're having a block party on the lawn. It's going to be fun. Let's show the neighborhood the church is alive. Eat some food trucks and listen to some live music. We'd love to see you there. Have a great Mother's Day. Have a great Mother's Day. We love you.